French Samo Tomšić, in his book on Marx and Lacan, he insists on, he tries to deploy systematically out of fragments of, different fragments in Lacan's work, something like Lacanian reading of Critique of Political Economy. And his basic point is a strict parallel between what Marx calls Mehrwert, surplus value, and between what Lacan calls plus de jouir, mehr genuss, surplus enjoyment. In other words, capitalism is something unique. It's not just one among the modes of production. It is what already Marx suspected. A mode of production in which some fundamental feature of the entire human civilization, precisely this logic of excess, always more, which was in a latent way always here but oppressed, rendered invisible by false stability, openly explodes. This is the moment of truth in those stupid theories that capitalism is a natural system. I'm simply saying the same as Marx when he says about labor, that universal labor appears as such as everyday experience only with capitalism. So what is this logic of surplus? Let me, to explain it, refer to a scene from a Hitchcock film, but a scene which Hitchcock never shot. And he was right not to do it because it would be too direct, a little bit vulgar. Namely, in his conversations with François Truffaut, Hitchcock recalls a scene that he wanted to insert into his classic movie North by Northwest. Here is his description of the scene. Listen carefully. I wanted to have a long dialogue between Cary Grant, who, the main role in the film, and one of the factory workers at the Ford automobile plant as they walk along the assembly line. Behind them, a car is being assembled piece by piece. You see everything, all components which go into a car. Finally, the car they have seen being put together from a simple nut and bolt is complete with gas and oil ready to drive off the line. The two men look at each other and say, "Isn't it wonderful?" One of them opens the door of the car and out drops a corpse. So, you see the point. The car was just, where did the corpse come from? I think this is what Lacan calls object small a, the surplus object. It comes from nowhere. And it's nice that, don't forget, if you are good Marxist, that Hitchcock describes here precisely the production process. And I think this corpse is somehow the surplus value, the surplus produced here. And so this, again, would have been what Lacan calls plus de jouir, a surplus which is totally non-substantial, but comes by. And there are many paradoxes to account for this. For example, I use this so I can repeat it here, I hope, just in one of my books. And a slightly obscene accident, but nobody will be hurt and wounded, that happened to me. Once, I will not say in which country, it would be too obscene, I talked with an elder lady, and my God, it's so shameful to say this. We were kind of flirting, and probably she wanted, she had some evil intentions with me. So she told me that her last, she was in her middle age, but beautiful. And she told me that her last lover, when he saw her naked, told her that, except for 1 or 2 kilo too much, her body is perfect. And I immediately told her, just don't try to lose that 1 or 2 kilos. Because, you know, this would be maybe the best example of what Lacan calls surplus enjoyment. Look, you appear as if you have 1 or 2 kilos too much. But this ideal of beauty, my God, how nice she would have been without that 1 or 2 kilos too much, is strictly a retroactive effect of those 1 or 2 kilos too much. You see the point? If you take 1 or 2 kilos too much away, you don't get a perfect body. You get an ordinary body. Because the perfection is precisely a retroactive effect of that very surplus which appears to destroy it. And this is how you should find in many movie stories and in real life this, let's call it, function of object A. And the same goes for Lacan, generally for libidinal economy. Another story, which I hope you don't know it, I quote it a couple of times in my book of the dysfunction of the excess object A. My friend, the British Lacanian, okay, half Lacanian, half Kleinian, if we go into this dogmatic theological functional struggles, Darian Leader told me a wonderful story, how once a patient of him told him a strange slip of tongue that he, the patient, made. She took a lady to a hotel restaurant, first to have dinner, and then, of course, with the evil intention to take her up to a room, to a bed, and so on. So what happened is that when they entered the restaurant, he made a stupid slip of tongue. Instead of a table for two, he said to the waiter, a bed for two, please, in the room. Now comes the genius of Darian Leader. His reading of this was not the usual Freudian vulgar one. Yeah, yeah, eating was just a pretext. He was already in his mind with later. But exactly the opposite. He was afraid to enjoy eating there too much. And that this will then, you know, ruin even his ability to perform properly sexually afterwards. So it was a kind of ethical reminder to himself. Don't enjoy eating here too much. Don't forget your true duty is up there later. You see here, this food eating there was object A. It was that surplus, but it should just remain a surplus if it is elevated too much into a self goal, it's a catastrophe. In this sense, already Freud proposed a wonderful concept. I think it's close to Lacan's plus de jouir, surplus enjoyment of Lustgewinn, gain of pleasure. How, when you do something, you should never forget that the true enjoyment comes not from the pleasure of achieving your goal, but from the very process of approaching your goal, and so on, and so on. What do I mean by this? Let me give you a very sad first political example, not political, sorry, everyday example from a friend of mine in the United States. He told me that recently, in the evening, he went to Walmart, that big supermarket, to buy something, and he noticed, it was the evening, close to closing time, near the exit, there were many those shopping carts full of stuff, commodities, but somebody abandoned them there. Why? He asked a salesperson there, and the salesperson told him, gave him a simple explanation. People who once had enough money to do regular shopping cannot any longer afford it. But the ritual means to them so much that regularly families come to Walmart store and imitate the form of shopping, fill things in, enjoy it, and then at the end they just leave the stuff there and go out. This is a nice example of how they get enjoyment, surplus enjoyment, but without the pleasure. The pleasure is the stupid pleasure of object you buy, but the real pleasure is, of course, the very procedure. Or let me give you the most terrifying example of this surplus enjoyment. You should watch it. It's terrifying, but such a supreme example of what Lacan meant by surplus enjoyment. Joseph Goebbels, you know, in 1943, after Stalingrad defeat of Germany, his famous speech in Berlin called the Total War, Totalkrieg speech. Why is this speech so interesting? You should listen to the words. Germans were shocked by the Stalingrad defeat, and Goebbels did a wonderful thing, wonderful in a terrifying sense. It would have been much better for him not to succeed so much. He decided, against the stupid opposition of many high-ranking Nazi people, not to downplay the catastrophe, but to emphasize it even more, to paint it in the darkest way. Let me read you a quote. Imagine all the Goebbels shouting and so on. I ask you, are you, the German nation, resolved to work 10, 12, and if need be, 14, 16 hours a day, if the Führer should command it, and to give all, your all for victory? I ask you, do you want total war? Do you want it, if need be, even more total and radical that we are capable of imagining it today? I ask you, is your confidence in the Führer more passionate, more unshakable than ever? Is your readiness to follow him on all his path and to do whatever is necessary to bring the war to a successful conclusion absolute and unlimited, and so on and so on? I will not quote it all, but the basic paradox is this one. What Goebbels' famous 20 or how much questions to the public, which are of course all answered with a resolute, yes, we are ready, there is no positive promise in them. It's simply, he's asking them, do you want to suffer more? You ain't seen nothing yet of suffering. Do you want to suffer more? Do you want to suffer to such an extent that you cannot even imagine how you will suffer? That's pleasure, surplus pleasure. Surplus enjoyment as opposed to pleasure. And it's extremely interesting to observe closely Goebbels' speech, his face during his speech, because when he gets into this full enthusiasm, do you want more suffering and so on, his resolute, fanatical face changes into a weird sort of passive pleasure, like as if he's overwhelmed by some excessive pleasure.